Well, we begin this morning Matthew 26. We have three more chapters in Matthew. I really, of course, all of the Bible is, but I really call the next three chapters holy ground, because we are now into the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. His arrest, his mock trial, his sufferings, his death, and the Lord's and his resurrection and ascension. Really, though all the scriptures are sacred, I think we really are standing on ground now that we really need to tread softly, slowly, compassionately, and prayed up. And I've tried, and I hope y'all have too, as we begin to walk through this. And it reminds us at what price our salvation. Amen. So, I probably will not have as much to expound on purpose, because this is more a matter of heart and emotion than lengthy exegesis, though there'd be some, of course. Some things need to be explained. But to me, this is really sacred ground. So in chapter 26, verse number 1, "And it came to pass when Jesus had finished all these sayings," his teaching ministry is over, his miracle ministry is over, his healing ministry is over, and the time, and God had a very set time in his life, in the life of the nation Israel, in the life of the Roman Empire, in the life of the Jewish nation. Everything is now at the exact time that the Lord had ordered. How many times before this specific point in biblical history and in the time of the Lord, how many times did his enemies want to kill him? But they couldn't, even when they tried, because it wasn't the time. It reminds me of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, where Solomon said, "There's a time for everything." Those of us who are in the upper years of our life, we've learned that everything in its time. You can do it too early and it won't work. You can do it too late and it won't come out right. But everything in its time. There's a time for every season. God is a God of order. Everything is time. Our birth is time by God. Our death is time by God. The events of our lives are timed. And we function best and things come out best when everything is done according to the Word of God in His time. Admittedly, it takes pretty much most of our lives before we finally learn that. Amen. "And it came to pass when Jesus had finished," emphasis on the word finished. By this time he had said and done everything that he came to say and to do, except the events that will now take place. So when he had finished all these sayings, technically the Sermon on the Mount, Oliver Discourse. But generally, all of his messages, he said unto his disciples, ye know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified. Now, he becomes personally the Passover. I don't know that you'll get much beyond this, because I need you now to go back to Exodus chapter number 12. Let me say this. This is the exodus of the nation Israel out of Egyptian bondage. There were a number of judgments on Egypt and Pharaoh the king. The Exodus and the Passover is intrinsically intertwined. The last judgment and the Exodus is intrinsically intertwined with the Passover. And the Passover becomes the Lord's Supper, the last Passover until Jesus comes to reign in the millennium, has given way to the Lord's Supper. We'll see that as we work through this. But first of all, I thought I would just do a short, not an exhaustive, but a short walkthrough of Exodus chapter 12, because verse 2 cannot be understood without Exodus chapter 12. So I want to walk you through the Passover, and it literally means what it says, passing over judgment. That's what the Passover means. So let's walk through this a little bit this morning. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. For a while it floated between March and April. Finally, because there were significant changes and additions and changes of calendars in the years after the first Passover, which is insignificant to our study today, but we're talking, the Jewish religious year began at Passover, just like the Christian life begins at our receiving the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for our sins, and judgment is passed over. You understand? That begins our spiritual journey. This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. The Jewish religious calendar begins at Passover in April. Speak unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb. Every lamb slain, every slaying and bloodshed speaks of John 1:29, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. According to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man, according to his eating, shall make your count for the lamb. And the lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep, or from the goats. And you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. Picturing, of course, the spotless Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening, just like the Lord. And they shall take the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door post of the house wherein they shall eat it. And because of where the blood was, it obviously was also spilled on the floor. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire, and unleavened bread. Unleavened means all leaven, speaks of sin, had to be put away. And bitter herbs, speaking of the bitterness of Egyptian bondage. And the application is very simple. When you and I receive Christ and accept the shed blood of the Savior, our lives should begin the process, as we'll talk this afternoon at 1:30, of sanctification, deliverance from sin, leaven, and a new nature has been given to us from the bitterness of the old life to the sweetness of the new life. Actually, we could take probably about 10 Sundays just on chapter 12, which would not be in the purpose now. Eat not of it raw or sodden or all with water, but roast with his head with his legs and with the pertinence thereof, and ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. The whole idea there being haste, because the death angel was coming. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand, because they were going to be delivered from Egyptian bondage that night. And ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover, type of the redemption of the Lord Jesus Christ. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, now this is the 10th plague, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. There was not a house in Egypt where there was not one dead. Both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The 10th plague was the judgment on the firstborn. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. All of this speaks of Christ. All of this speaks of the coming judgment of God on this world, and only those who are under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ will not have to face the final judgment that's coming to modern Egypt, speaking of the world.
Amen.
And this day shall be unto you for a memorial. And ye shall keep it a feast of the Lord throughout your generation. She shall keep a feast by an ordinance forever. By the way, they didn't. Actually, they didn't do that many Passover feasts for a number of reasons. The prominent one being is they did not walk with the Lord. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day ye shall put away leaven out of your houses, for whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. And there's deep significance in that. And by the way, when we get to our lesson this afternoon of sanctification, more of that will come out. The point is, once you're under the blood, you don't keep living in sin. And provision is made for erring and falling into sin, but you don't live in sin anymore. And in the first day there shall be an holy convocation, the first day of the week of unleavened bread, in which the Passover is a holy day, a Sabbath. And the seventh day is a holy Sabbath. And in the seventh day there shall be an holy convocation to you. No man of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done for you. There is a deeply interesting and significant study in the history of the nation Israel, how God blessed them or judged them based on how they did or did not keep the Sabbath. Just like in the New Testament, there is significant teaching on the blessing or the withholding of blessing of God's people who violate the principle of one day out of seven for worship and rest. A sadly neglected principle, not taught or preached or practiced amongst believers today. We assume, because we do not keep the Sabbath, which is Saturday, but the principle, and we worship on Sunday, but the principle of one day out of seven for rest and worship, we have not been delivered from that. We still owe that to the Lord. And like I say, that's an interesting study. And ye shall observe the Feast of Unleavened Bread. There were three feasts that all the males were supposed to appear before the Lord for worship, cleansing and worship. Unleavened Bread, the Passover, and the fall festival after Thanksgiving. For in this selfsame day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall ye observe this day in your generations for an ordinance forever. Now, first of all, they did not do this very many years. Now they don't do it at all because there is no temple. And it will be restored during the millennium. That would be another way out discussion away from us. All we're trying to do is give you an explanation of what the Passover is. It speaks for Christ. It speaks of the passing over of judgment to those who are under the blood. Everything about the Passover, and like I say, I could spend weeks just in this chapter explaining how it typifies Christ and what that means for us. Verse 18, in the first month, April, on the 14th day of the month, at even ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 20th day of the month at even. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses, for whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even the soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether it be a stranger or born in the land. It's interesting that even there, provision was made for Gentiles. The blood, the Jewish people were wrong. They thought the blood and redemption was only for them. No, the stranger, that would be the Gentile. Even the salvation of Gentiles was provided for by the blood of Christ. Ye shall eat nothing leavened, in all your habitations shall eat unleavened bread. And then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike your lintels on the two sides of the post with the blood that is in the basin, and none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. Because judgment was coming that night. And as long as they were under the blood, they were saved. Just like you and I are saved. Saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, judgment was averted. just like judgment will be averted again on this world. The believers were kept safe and preserved from judgment. For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. It's a picture of what is yet to come again. And when he seeth the blood upon the lintel on the two sides, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you. And you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever. Salvation, once you're under the blood, it's forever. You cannot lose your salvation. And it shall come to pass, when ye be come to the land which the Lord will give you, according as he hath promised, that ye shall keep this service. And as I said, they did not do it very often. And it shall come to pass, when your children shall say unto you, what mean ye by this service? That ye shall say, it's the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. And the people bowed the head and worshipped. And the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. So, the only thing, back to Matthew 26, the only thing that we need to draw for our lesson today is the fact that the Passover, the passing over of judgment, was based on blood. And every lamb ever slain was fulfilled, according to John 1:29, in the Lord Jesus Christ, who became the Lamb. John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And when you received Christ and his shed blood, you were redeemed, saved, and never to be brought into judgment. Now it's an amazing thing that the Jews had all of this in minutest detail and didn't get it. Now there were Jews amongst the Jewish people who understood this and thus were saved. But obviously, as we shall see, the majority of the nation did not, and certainly the Jewish leaders did not. So, verse 1 and 2 again, and we can go on now, of Matthew 26. And it came to pass, when Jesus had finished all these things, he said unto his disciples, you know that after 2 days, the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified. Jesus Christ now becomes the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Then assembled together the chief priests and the scribes and the elders of the people unto the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas. I want you to look at these people who will now lead the charge in killing the Lord. The chief priests, the scribes, whose full-time job it was 6 days a week, all day long, they copied out the scriptures, and the elders of the people. These were all religious leaders. These were not secular leaders. These were religious leaders, the spiritual leaders of the nation. And they gathered together unto the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, the son-in-law to Annas. Now Caiaphas had a particular hatred of the Lord Jesus Christ, because he was threatened by Christ. He felt threatened by Christ. One of the lessons, good lessons, that I was taught early as a young man, and I'm glad I was, by the man that trained me and by the men of the seminary where I attended, was to always be on guard, quite frankly, against most preachers. Strange enigma. A preacher having to be on guard against other preachers. But that principle is played out in our story today. It was the preachers, it was the religious leaders who gathered together to plot the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the group in verse 4. And they consulted that they might take Jesus by subtlety and kill him. I want you to notice, first of all, by subtlety. There are many, 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 many men and women in ministry today who are in subtlety. They're not honest. They're not saved. They're not in it for the cause of Christ. They're not in it for the good of the people. They are imposters. They're not called by God. And notice, their plan was to kill the Lord. Now, we first of all, from the human side, we have to look at the meanness of such a thing. But from the divine side, we have to look at the only perfect being to ever walk among men. And that's who they want to kill. But they said, not on the feast day, lest there be an uproar among the people. Now, I want you to notice something. The most religious high day in the nation. And they were plotting the Lord's death. And notice what their fear was. Not the Lord, not God, but the people. Lest there be an uproar among the people. You know, I learned something a long time ago, and it's not an easy lesson. You keep learning it over and over, but you can't serve the Lord if you're going to fear the people. You just can't do that. Sometimes you just have to say, folks, this is right, and that's what we're going to do. And if somebody gets mad, they just get mad. And if somebody leaves, they just leave. There are a few times in life, there are a few times in the Lord's work when you just have, this is right, and that's what we're going to do. Period. So they feared the people. Now, while that is going on, the Lord is having a meal, the last meal, with his friends. So, beginning in verse number 6, now when Jesus was in Bethany, you understand the Lord never knew where he was going to get his next meal from. The Lord never knew where he was going to sleep the next night. Y'all understand that? I mean, you can't comprehend it, but we understand that. However, he did have a few friends at Bethany where he could go for a meal and some peace and some quiet. Now, when Jesus was in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, someone he had healed, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box. Now, we all know from the other, this is also recorded, Mark 14 and in John 12. We know this lady was Mary, the sister of Martha. A study of her life shows that of all the people around the Lord, this was the only one who clearly understood what was fixing to happen. The disciples didn't. Mary was the most spiritual person, and she understood. Now, the mother of Jesus at this point is not in the picture. I'm talking about that inner circle of his disciples and a few friends. This was the only, Mary was the only one who understood what was going to happen. There came unto him a woman having an alabaster box, a very precious ointment, worth about a day's work. And the other records show it was the ointment. The perfume was worth a year's pay. And the alabaster box made out of rare Egyptian marble was worth a week's pay. That's the reason you'll see in a minute everybody had a fear about her, what she did. There came unto him a woman having an alabaster box, a very precious ointment, and poured it, and we know she broke the box, and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. Now, they didn't sit at a table like we do. They sat on the floor. So this was easy. But when his disciples, and what she was doing, we'll explain in a minute. And when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? Now, we need to talk about that a minute. First of all, John tells us the instigator of this discussion was Judas, who was about to betray him. And Judas was the treasurer. He had the bag. And he was helping himself sometimes to walk to the money in the bag. So he was the one that instigated, and of course the disciples fell right in there with him. But when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? Now, first of all, nothing done for the Lord is ever a waste. Your tithe is never a waste. The visits you make are never a waste. The phone calls you make are never a waste. Your study time, your fellowship time with the Lord, your worship time, your spending time here is never a waste. A life given to the Lord is never a waste. So they made a terrible statement there. And here's how they reasoned humanly. This ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor. Now, what the Lord is saying is not a disparagement to the poor. He's just making a point. When Jesus understood it, he said unto them, why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me. I want you to notice the difference of opinion here. Now, here was this service done to the Lord. And the disciples and Judas said, you did a terrible thing. Jesus said, you did a good thing. Now, when you do something, folks, do it as unto the Lord. Because people may not understand. People may not appreciate. People may not see it. Because they can't see your heart. They don't know why you're doing what you're doing. By the way, those of us who are watching somebody else do something, don't criticize. Because we don't understand. They didn't understand. They said she was doing it. Well, what a terrible thing she did. Jesus said she did a good thing. Do it as unto the Lord. For you have the poor always with you, but me, you have not always. What you do for the Lord is never wasted, folks. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. First of all, she understood. The only one at this point. The others were later. But at this point, only she understood what was fixing to happen. And this was a symbolic act of worship. This was a pure act of worship, because she knew the Lord was going to die for her sins. And so, here's her reward. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this that this woman hath done be told for a memorial of her. Here's a great lesson in worship. You do it as unto the Lord. Your service is really worship. And reckon, folks, just go ahead and reckon that folks are not always going to understand. But it doesn't matter. The least little thing done in the name of the Lord for His glory will not be forgotten and will always be rewarded, if not now, then definitely in the life that is to come. Now, I want to read the next three verses, and then next week I'm going to do a whole lesson on Judas. Then one of the 12, now I want you to notice, one of the 12, Judas had a ministry, but he wasn't. He wasn't a Christian. Judas was not a believer. Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests and said unto them, "What will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you." And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. That was the price of a slave. If you were going to buy a slave, it would have cost you 30 pieces of silver. And from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him. The most dastardly deed ever done by a human being on planet Earth. The question is, why was there a Judas in the apostolate? I will do a whole lesson on that next Sunday morning. So, it's just about 4 minutes earlier than I normally quit, but I'm going to go ahead and quit there because folks are coming in. Next week we will study Judas and have some applications for us even out of that.